Welcome back, everybody. Airline CEOs and other industry leaders rallied in Washington to plea for more aid as they face major cuts at the end of this month. Joining us right now to debate the issue of bailing out the airline industry is Sara Nelson. She is international president of the Association of Flight Attendants. Also joining us today, Veronique DeRougy. She is a senior research fellow at George Mason University's Mercatus Center. And welcome, ladies, to both of you. Sara, I think you'd probably even take issue with the way I just announced this as a bailout for the airline industry. I know that you are facing some big cuts in jobs starting October 1st if additional aid doesn't come. What's your take on the situation right now?
The take is that we have to look at this not just as an airline industry issue. This is an entire country issue. And what we're trying to do is deal with the largest crisis that our country has faced in over 100 years, certainly the largest crisis that the airline industry has ever faced. And so the idea is that we need to keep as many people strong as possible during this coronavirus pandemic and try to attack the virus. So if we're keeping people in our jobs and out of the unemployment line, they're able to continue to spend into the economy. This was a resolution that was supposed to be a template for other industries as well, and it's really a jobs program. This is not a bailout for the airline industry. It's a relief program for the country and an ability to keep us strong so that we can continue to pay our rents, continue to buy our groceries, continue to take care of our families with our health care. And that's really what this is about. So it's not about the airline industry, but it's about providing the aid so that we can have the airline industry do non-economic things in the middle of a crisis, such as keeping people in their jobs and continuing service to all of our communities.
Hey, Veronique, you very recently wrote a column suggesting that this should not happen, that this is a bailout for shareholders, not for employees. What do you say to Sara on that point when she says, look, this will keep she and her fellow workers at least able to be performing in the economy when some of these shutdowns have been forced by the government themselves?
Yeah, I sympathize with what's going on with the airline industry. In fact, I sympathize with everything that is going on in the economy. The airline industry is not the only industry affected. 60 to 70% of restaurants who have closed will never open again. This pandemic is a tragedy. I'm an economist. I study bailouts. Bailouts are always end up being a bailout. It is a bailout, by the way. And this is how Congress called it. This is how the industry has called it out of the gate. And this is always ends up being a bailout to the shareholders and not to the worker. The workers are used as a prop to actually kind of make the case that we should do this. But the reality, the economic reality of this, is that in the end, the airlines have a lot of assets that they can help them right through this horrible times. And also, this is not a temporary crisis. This could be a good idea to try to actually keep people in their jobs if we were in this for 6 months. But according to travel experts, we could be in this for up to 7 years before travel goes back to normal. Now, I assume it's going to be much shorter than this, but even if it's 3 years, it's a long time. This is not sustainable. The industry needs to adjust. There's no risk, systemic risks. The airlines have a lot of assets that they can use to get access to the capital market or to use as collateral. They have the bankruptcy process that they can go through that they have used in the past successfully, continue to fly. And yes, there will be adjustment, but this, if the bailout of March has told us anything, is that this is just postponing the inevitable. And so we need to do it. And there is a reason why airlines are always the first one out of the gate. Okay, is because bailouts, they get more bailouts.
Right. Sara, let me ask you this. Would you be in favor of providing taxpayers with, and we've talked about this before, a stake in these airlines? It effectively would dilute current shareholders, including some employees who own shares. But would you advocate for something like that if it kept your employees in their job?
So the taxpayers and the government did get a stake in this. They did take a stake in warrants in the grants that were awarded to the airlines. So there is a stake there. And Secretary Mnuchin made sure that would happen.
Sara, I'm talking about a one-to-one stake, meaning for every dollar in, you get a dollar out. Not the way those warrants worked, as you know, it was very, very limited. You know, when you compare, for example, by the way, the way the bailouts in 2008 took place with the banks ultimately paid back the money and more to taxpayers. It is almost impossible to see that take place in the current warrant situation in terms of how that bailout took place with the airlines now. In fact, it's you can't get the money back. So my question to you is, would you advocate in favor of a program in which the taxpayer not only would be made whole, but would actually do well if the airlines do well, but it would protect your, it would in the hopefully long term protect your employees?
Andrew, if we're talking about re-regulating the industry, then we're all in favor of that. We've been in favor of that since 1979 when the industry deregulated. But we're talking about private business here who are making decisions, and they have to enroll in these programs. And so the airlines are not going to enroll in a program where that is being taken over. And so that's not going to work for keeping workers in our jobs. That's not going to work for keeping this jobs program going that has been the most effective use of taxpayer money, so that we don't have people on the unemployment lines and we're not paying more and going into an economic depression. These airline workers who are working at the airlines are credentialed safety professionals who have to go through training, who provide the backbone service of the entire economy to keep us going. And if we have people out of their jobs, we're going to have a slower recovery. We also have right now, we have service cuts to certain communities because the airlines are making economic decisions to put planes on the ground because they don't have the access to the funds to be able to do that. So they're making decisions in the market. The market is driving those decisions. We're asking them to do non-economic things, keeping people in their jobs and keeping the service community to the, all of these communities so the U.S. mail can continue, so the veterans can continue to get their medicines. And we are right in the middle of the crisis. We are going to be in a very different place in 6 months when we are closer to a testing regimen and a vaccine. And in the meantime, we've got real people who are going to continue to get their paychecks. Restructuring for what? Restructuring for a 30% demand? It is not normal. These are not, the airlines are not in trouble because of business decisions. The airlines were doing better than they ever had been before coronavirus hit. And we're still right in the middle of the crisis. That's what we have to make very clear.
Sarah,
and they have the assets.
To Veronique's point, Sarah, to Veronique's point.
They need these assets before they ask taxpayers to get in. Again.
I'm sorry, what was that, Veronique?
I said, yes, the airlines were doing extremely well, and they have a lot of assets that they can use to actually restructure. And I understand this is a long-term issue. There's going to be restructuring needed and not to the level permanently that we are today. That said, they have a lot of assets. The first step that they need to take is use their own assets before they ask taxpayers yet again to get it and come bail them out. And second, they can go through the bankruptcy process. The bankruptcy process keeps a lot of creditors at bay.
Well, they don't have our pensions anymore. They took our pensions in bankruptcy before. They took our pay. They restructured in bankruptcy before. They don't have the assets off of our backs to take anymore. Labor costs were reduced during those bankruptcies, and we felt the brunt of that. And that's why this proposal was from us. It was from the workers in March.
Yes,
to keep us in our jobs, to keep the airlines running. This crisis is bigger than anything any market can handle. And that's just the fact of the matter. And so what we're trying to do is to continue to keep the U.S. economy going with this relief program that has been the most successful jobs program of all of coronavirus.
What about restaurant workers? What about the leisure industry? What about the cruise industry?
And we have said very much that this needs to be a template for every other industry. All of these industries need this relief.
Can I ask
we need this relief as a
Sarah, can I ask? Sarah, can I ask? Okay, ladies, can I ask a question? Guys, before we keep chatting over each other, can I ask a question? Sarah, you say that this is a template for other industries. I don't see Congress moving on anything, at least before Election Day. Do you see a different idea than that?
Well, we're saying that they have to. They don't have a choice here. We are going to go into an economic depression if they don't take action. And this is a call from every single industry, as you have said, the restaurant industry as well. We need a relief package right now so that we don't have businesses going out of business and people losing jobs forever and having a harder recovery. Well, what we're seeing is that
my question is very specifically, do you think that there will be a deal cut between October 1st? Do you think there?
I I think that there will be a deal cut before October 1st because they don't have a choice. And we have so much agreement on Capitol Hill right now with the White House, with both parties, and we have legislation moving. And I see this happening because they just don't, simply do not have a choice. And the election is putting pressure to make sure that there is not mass job loss as of October 1st.
Yeah, and we're just going to be postponing the inevitable. What, mark my words, we're only postponing the
inevitable. That is pretty mean-spirited for the people who are looking at not having a paycheck or health care in the middle of a pandemic.
All of the time.
And so I'm just not going to accept that because
the
people that I know, the people that I represent are right now looking at not knowing how to pay their rent. They're looking at moving their things into their car and trying to figure out how to survive. After 9/11, we had other places to go, but we don't have anywhere else to go right now. So this is how we're going to recover the entire country.
I want to thank you both for being here today. Obviously, this is an issue we'll be following closely between now and October 1st, but thank you for your time.